The six items I present here are not only iconic, they more clearly reveal the nature of the Phantom and his ancient origins, and by extension are an inseparable part of the story itself. The opera ghost spent many of his years in Persia building royal palaces, which helped give him renown enough to design the Palais Garnier years later. No doubt the architect, with an artistic eye and passion for beauty, took great pains to create the proscenium we see before us in this adaptation. Of course, not only are the managers basically tenants of the space, from his backstory, we realize he oversaw every stone set in its place from the beginning. While the Paris Opera House itself not only does not feature a full sculptural relief proscenium for its stage, it doesn't feature Pan or Fauns in any of its decor at all. The set and costume designer Maria Bjornson's artistic liberty no doubt improved upon the prototype's original design for the sake of silent storytelling. However, this interesting detail may help lead us to understand the mythos of the Phantom better if we journey yet a little deeper. The shuffle through the aisles to find our seats is punctuated by curious glances at the stage, which is set with a gloomy aesthetic. The strange shapes concealed in dust covers probe the imagination as a poignant foreshadowing. The lights fade, and we're brought to the scene of an auction. And not much later, the dust cover is ripped off with a blast of sparks. Magnesium as the sparks ignite to awaken it, and if we're lucky enough to hear the crystals rattle as it passes overhead before its iconic crash, we immediately realize we are not passive observers as audience members. We're participants, helping the magic come to life. This moment is present in stagings around the world. It has been very reverently replicated by smaller companies and amateur productions as worthy tributes to the vision of the original creative minds behind it. As the chandelier ascends from a dusty piece of repaired junk under an auction's dust covers, it grows in luminosity and glitters flawlessly. The stage itself starts removing layers of curtains and haphazard backdrops, as if peeling back the years the opera house has sat in neglect. Around the stage are sculptures of nymphs and fauns, or angels and demons, wrapped in a sensual struggle, which additionally sets the passionate overtone for the story to be told under their watchful, glowing eyes. In the center, three angels are pursued, and it is the center angel's wingspan that is the crowning jewel of every single set on the stage underneath. Connecting our story back to Greek myth for a moment, we should study the overarching themes both share: metamorphosis or transformation. Accompanying this theme is often violence inflicted upon a victim whose transformation becomes part of the natural landscape. If the proscenium, and by extension the entire theater, is this outlying natural landscape, it's interesting to observe him using it as a perch multiple times during the production. This theme amalgamates the much-explored opposition between the hunter and the hunted, and the thematic tension between art and nature. The proscenium and the angel both become a landscape, bringing the phantom's superhuman power over the audience by providing hiding spots for his presence, and as a result, we become participants in the self-aware production. Here, yet another myth revealed itself to us. Pan, the horned and hooved god, horrified mortals and nymphs with his beast-like appearance, and, like Hephaestus, he was rejected by his birth parents. The word panic itself derives its meaning from his voice, which was as terrifying as his appearance. He is intimately associated with music and eroticism, although he was rejected by all potential lovers until he concealed his beastly appearance to seduce the moon goddess Selene. He lost a musical competition with Apollo and his lyre, which itself became the symbol of musical prowess. Maria pays homage to the Paris Opera House by incorporating Apollo's lyre and garlands into the set and prop design, which is found everywhere inside the original building, including on the design of the chandelier itself. As a chorus girl, part of the ballet ensemble, it is a curious detail that Christine has her own room, but it is not inexplicable. My theory is this. Upon leaving Christine to the care of the opera, her famous father may have attempted to use his influence to help make her comfortable in her own room, an arrangement the Phantom may have finished by leveraging previous opera managers. This also would have solidified the ambiguity in Christine's mind of the Phantom as the spirit of her father. The awkward dressing room scene in the book brings meaning to an overlooked lyrical detail inside the production. The voice declares his love for Christine, and she in turn tells him that she has given him her soul. As Christine is seated at her vanity, she is fearful of her angel's reaction to her friendly reminiscing with Raoul. She apologizes that her soul was weak. Through the backstory Christine gives us with her first musical numbers, we know he is more than familiar to her. He's her teacher, guardian, and what she calls an angel. The Phantom is revealed to us and to Christine, not through a trapdoor, or behind a garden wall, or even through empty darkness. Inside the mirror, in her personal dressing room, distorting her reflection, we see him. Like Pan, his terrifying voice precedes him, which startles us and our protagonist. Concealing his frightening appearance, with his wing-like cloak, he covers the object of his desire, his Selene. The same score which brought us the triumphant ascent of the chandelier brings us the fearful descent to his lair. Instead of the much more practical and period correct option of gas or oil lamps, Hal Prince, the director, specifically notes the phallic imagery in the lit candles which emerge from the lake, which was meticulously designed for the camp aspect. Though I truly don't believe it is for that reason alone his lair is lit by candlelight. Obviously, aside from the romantic aspect, the costume choice for Christine in this scene may divulge a hidden truth. The gentle curves of the ruffles down the length of her robe echoes the melting wax. He certainly moves with sure, slow movements around her, as if she may indeed burn him if he lingers too long or holds contact for more than the briefest of moments. With lithe footsteps, he never turns his back on her, demonstrating the mastery of his domain, every object in its place, and with Christine as the illumination, like Selene the moon goddess. Like a moth to the flame, or a love-struck sculptor, he can't take his eyes off of her. After a time, a massive gate lowers at the motion of his hands, making his lair inaccessible to anyone outside, and inescapable to those within. His ancient roots to Pygmalion are most apparent here, where he uncovers the mirror bride. As Christine approaches, like the goddess of beauty Aphrodite, the visage moves toward her. After this moment, Christine, for all intents and purposes, fills the role as phantom sculpture, first admired and shaped from afar, finally come to life in warm reality. In history, which helped inspire Gaston's work of fiction, a 200-pound counterweight for the chandelier fell through the theater's ceiling and crushed an audience member. The story obviously creates a more traumatic version of the historical event, with nothing but a touchless command from the Phantom from his perch in the proscenium, the chandelier throws itself directly onto the stage, enacting his revenge against the petrified cast of characters. An interesting historical nod to the original event is the timing, directly at the close of Act 1, for both occasions. He warns the ignorant managers many times, and with the use of multiple speakers and illusion, our phantom appears effortlessly anywhere he pleases in or around the stage. As helpless onlookers, we respect his superhuman abilities and internally chide the cast of fools to listen to his warnings. If we'd been in their place, we'd like to think we would take the threat seriously before calamity strikes. As if aware of our fearful reflections, Phantom, or our beloved companion the Chandelier, does not betray the trust we've given it as a one-ton character, hovering ominously above our heads, suspended on impossibly thin wires. It flashes and falls threateningly, but ultimately swings harmlessly over us to destroy the livelihood and integrity of the opera populaire instead. The masquerade at the opening of the second act is perhaps the most iconic scene in the story, with the exception of the candlelit lair. The historical building with its magnificent staircase was built for people watching, as opera attendance in earlier eras was not only for the enjoyment of the stage, but for observing the aristocrats and wealthy. Somehow, we pick up on this feeling with the simple set design, not only before the appearance of the Mask of the Red Death, but during every moment of the story. The use of off-center, asymmetrical, empty space gives us the feeling we may be watched from the shadows, sentiments not unlike our protagonists. Here, costume design, sense of balance, style, and artistic direction takes flight, and we delight in the merriment and cheerful colors as a breath of fresh air from the dark earth tones and somber themes in the first act, relating very much to the lyrics here, which assert that the characters feel the same way. Finally, from the top of the stairs, he appears. This moment from LaRue's story is identical. The Phantom dresses as the visage of the Red Death, replicated nearly stitch for stitch from the silent film as an obvious tribute to the cinematic scene.
If you think that I had left you for good.
It's illustrated in LaRue's novel, taking a direct reference to the short story, The Mask of the Red Death by Edgar Allan Poe, in which a deadly plague takes on physical form and appears to a wealthy ruling class party while the peasants outside are suffering and dying. No doubt the opera ghost related to this literary statement, which also is alluded to in the silent film, where he ominously remarks, "Beneath your dancing feet are the tombs of tortured men. Thus does the Red Death rebuke your merriment." Our Phantom insults, shames, and intimidates the cast and then disappears in a fiery explosion, only to immediately appear at the top of the stairs again as he terrorizes the participants and our horrified protagonists flee the scene. Hal Prince reveals that the woman who brought us the ingenious design for the production felt as passionately about the details as the sentimental fans she inspired. I remember walking away from Maria Bjornson's model showing feeling blown away and somewhat daunted, knowing what a huge challenge it was to do all she wanted with the money and time we had available, and realizing everything she wanted was absolutely vital to her complete way of visually interpreting the story. For the rest of the musical, Maria chose to leave out many visual details. You are compelled to fill in the blanks, and each person in the audience sees it differently. You provide the missing wallpaper, you even provide the elaborate sweeping garnier staircase, which is merely a metal frame with unpolished wooden slats. Part of the allure of Phantom sets lies in how they draw the audience into them. Maria said that a set should always have a dynamic of its own, even without actors in it. It mustn't just sit there like an empty box. Maria's costumes, somewhere around 200 of them, are as much the scenery itself, and she designed them all within 10 days. Hal Prince tells us that the entire experience of working with Maria was exhilarating, energetic, and professional, and devoid of any disagreement. The Paris Opera House was, naturally, the main inspiration, with its lake in the basement. What I loved was the big circular descent that was like going into the subconscious. I started with a straight staircase. From there, I got the idea of the lantern with striations in it, and from there we got the idea of the striations as a way of lighting the entire thing. I had seen a picture of Venice that had reflections in the water, and this is where I got the idea of the candles. Maria, like many designers, was inspired by other artists. Perhaps the picture she remembered was actually the beginning of the Venice sequence in the 1951 film Tales of Hoffman, designed by Hein Heckroth. With Maria's love of stagecraft, she also drew inspiration from expressionist German films. We can appreciate her more refined aesthetics by comparison, considering the themes of cinematic horror were very heavy-handed as they pioneered the genre. She had a much more effeminate approach with the use of shadow and delicate set design. Her love of textiles and drapery is another defining feature that is the stagecraft for the production, which allowed for almost instant, seamless set transitions until the operas appear, which are always full of color and a satirical-like symmetry. The strength in her work came from a rigorous intellect, carefully analyzing a text or immersing herself in a score to get to the essence and heart of the creation. As she wrote, "People think it's liberating to be able to do anything, but it's not. You have to find the dynamic from the text, not a fantasy idea you have. What you're trying to do is hone yourself down, to reduce and reduce until you discover exactly what you're trying to resolve. Designing is about finding out what the problems are by asking the right questions. From these, you move to the visuals." The merging of fantasy and reality, critics would call a flaw in design, Maria considered essential. As well as spectacular grandeur and grown-up sensual glamour, her work also showed love for the charm of dreamy childhood, mirroring perhaps what she had so longed for when young. But there's also a keen, unsentimental eye for fun and the weaknesses of mankind. There's often wit, sometimes irony, but her work never lacked humanity, and always enhanced a truth that touched so many. As she said, "I am absolutely certain of whom I am doing it for. I am doing it for the audience."